So let us become centered and open our hearts to receive whatever the Spirit would have us receive here today. And before we hear the prelude in this spirit of prayer, I'd like to set the context and share the words, because this is one of the most beautiful and moving pieces of music I think ever written. The disciple Peter has just heard the cock crow and realized that he has denied Jesus three times, as Jesus said he would. And Peter cries out in the words of this aria, "Have mercy, my God, for the sake of my tears. See, my heart and eyes weep bitterly. Have mercy."
Thank you.
I don't know if I can speak. I'm sorry. That was so beautiful. So beautiful. Let us read the responsive blessing of the light you'll find printed in your order of worship. In Christ was life, and the life was the light of the world. Let us pray for peace and the things that make for peace as we light the peace candle. I didn't want either of those pieces ever to end. Thank you so much. Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to the United Church of Strafford on this second Sunday in Lent. And welcome to those of you in the sanctuary, and welcome also to those of you online. And welcome especially to the Canternote Church musicians and all you have given us already. Thank you so much. We acknowledge that we are on the ancestral and unceded land of the traditional caretakers, the Western Wabanaki people. Our congregation has voted to establish a reparations fund for the hardships that they have had to endure here from colonial times unto this day. And we give thanks to the opportunity to share in the bounty of this place and to protect it. Jesus taught that the Spirit that created and still flows through all the earth is about nurturing and evolving life, and ultimately bringing new life out of death. It is a spirit of mercy, justice, and peace, of healing, compassion, and love. We just heard a painfully beautiful expression of grief and remorse in the Prelude. Johann Sebastian Bach put all his experience of suffering into its music, and the disciple Peter, whose voice is speaking, went on to put all of his experience of suffering into creating a community that followed the sacred way. The Spirit helps us become a blessing to others as a result of our painful experiences, as much as our joyful ones, as much through our wilderness trials as through our time in the Promised Land. Someone here today may need the very gifts of wisdom and compassion that you have to offer from your experience. So I invite you to linger after the service and strengthen this loving community by reaching out especially to those you do not know or those you know are in need of care and support. And we have visitors here today, but we are all one family here in this moment. Please see the many important announcements in the bulletin. If you are online, you can find the bulletin in the menu at the top of the welcome page of our website, and I highly recommend that you go there and see the bulletin. For those in the sanctuary, please stay for refreshments and the comfort of neighborliness in the parish hall after the service. For those of you who are on Zoom, please extend yourselves to one another when the service ends, and I will get on my laptop as quickly as I can to visit with you, and some others here may join me. Are there other announcements that need to be made today?
I know you can all read, and the type is very large, so you can really read, but on the back of the bulletin is an announcement about a book study club discussion of the book Becoming Nicole, which is part of this congregation's exploration of whether or not to become an open and affirming church. The book is pretty remarkable. It's being sponsored by both the church and the library, both of whom have a great interest in people learning new things. And so we hope that you will either buy the book and read it and come to the discussion, or that you will get it out of the library where they have a whole bunch of interlibrary loan copies and read it and come to the discussion, which will be both in person and on Zoom.
Starting next Tuesday.
Right, starting next Tuesday.
Yeah. You may have all seen this on the Wayside pulpit out in front, but Anamika McLean will be giving a concert this afternoon at 4 o'clock here.
Also happening this week, there's a lot of stuff all over the place, but on Thursday the 9th at 6:30 up at the Sharon Academy High School, there is a presenter named Lynn Lyons, who is a well-known, well, I guess it depends on which circles you travel in, but some people know her well as an anxiety expert, and she is a therapist and works with children and families and adults, and it is a free presentation for youth, their caregivers, people who love them, people who know children, anybody in the community. And it is also a collaboration between the Sharon Academy and the White River Valley Supervisory Union, funded by different grants. So it's a really, really hoping that many, many people will come. It's online as well as in person up there. 6:30 to 8:30.
Two wilderness journeys serve as metaphors for Lent, the season of Lent, which we are in. The 40 days that Jesus spent being tempted and tried, and the 40 years that Moses and the children of Israel wandered lost. In both cases, there was a place that they had in mind that they were trying to reach. For Moses, it was the promised land. For Jesus, it was a new consciousness, a new way of being, filled with the Holy Spirit. Lent is designed to help us reach a new place, to undergo an inner transformation that will help us then transform the world around us. Jesus says, "Ask and it will be given you. Search and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened for you." The prophet Jeremiah says, "When you search for me, you will find me. If you seek me with all your heart, I will let you find me." So let us worship together, continuing our Lenten journey to a new place. Our reader is Joey Hawkins.
Please join me in the unison reading from Psalm 121, the King James Version. I will lift up mine eyes unto the hills, from whence cometh my help. My help cometh from the Lord, which made heaven and earth. He will not suffer thy foot to be moved. He that keepeth thee will not slumber. Behold, he that keepeth Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is thy keeper. The Lord is thy shade upon thy right hand. The sun shall not smite thee by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord shall preserve thee from all evil. He shall preserve thy soul. The Lord shall preserve thy going out and thy coming in from this time forth and even forevermore. Here ends the reading.
Oh,
come to our children's time, and I'd like to just ask the children if you do you want to come up or do you want to stay where you are? Yeah, you want to stay. You want to stay where you are. Okay. Yeah, I was a back pew guy. I used to sit. In fact, when I came here as a lay person in 1983, I think. I used to sit back in that corner as far from the pulpit as I could possibly be. And look where I ended up. So let that be a warning to you. So good morning.
Good morning.
So I've been talking lately about the extremely wise woman, Robin Wall Kimmerer, in her book Braiding Sweetgrass. And she wrote, "Knowing that you love the earth changes you. It activates you to defend and protect and celebrate the earth. But when you feel that the earth loves you in return, that feeling transforms the relationship into a sacred bond." So Robin asks people, do you love your garden? I mean, do you love your garden? Yeah. So, and when people say yes, she asks, and does your garden love you? Yeah, well, think of all the joy of a tomato plant. Think of the joy that the tomato plant shows when we give it the kind of soil and water and weeding and loving care and appreciation that, you know, it deserves. So, and it needs. So don't you think that your garden loves you? I mean, you just put in a little bit and look at what it gives you back. So in the Bible's Garden of Eden story, the creator of the earth places humans here to work with the earth, to produce what we need, and to do it in such a way that the earth keeps on being healthy forever. We're here to till it and to keep it healthy. So Robin is a college earth science professor, botanist, and when she asks her students to name ways that humans hurt the earth, they have a long list. But then she asks them to list ways that humans help the earth, and they sit there in silence. But we have a role to play in the natural ecosystems of earth. I mean, the spirit of life worked hard for billions of years to evolve from single cells, squiggly little things, into the incredibly complex consciousness of the human brain. So humans must have our part to contribute to the health and well-being of the earth. That's why we were evolved. The fact that we are messing up now in many ways does not take away from the truth that the earth loves us and wants us and needs us to play our positive role in the care and the evolution of life. Robin and a student of hers studied sweetgrass. Sweetgrass is a long, thin-bladed grass that's used by tribal basket makers, indigenous basket makers. And Robin and the student found that the harvesting of it, which people thought would hurt the grass, actually increases the health of sweetgrass. Because of the respectful way that indigenous people harvest it, which is to take only half, and they actually give a gift of thanks, and they ask the permission of the plant. It's very respectful. And the plant flourishes. In fact, in the places where it's not harvested, sweetgrass is dying out. But where native populations are harvesting it, it's flourishing. So the earth loves us, and the spirit of the earth needs us to play our role in creating the conditions for life to flourish, conditions of sustainability and harmony and peace, of understanding and compassion and love for all people, for all creatures, all plants, all places. But this is hard in our day-to-day life, especially in our culture, and if we are not sure what our role is in any given situation, the spirit will gladly tell us, but we need to learn how to hear it and feel it guiding us. And there is a tool that we learn in church that helps us do exactly that. Anybody guess? Pray. So prayer, especially when it is a contemplative prayer or meditation or mindfulness, any prayer where we listen more than talk, the fewer the words, the better, it really helps us hear our inner spirit and helps us know how to be on this earth. So let us pray together now the new version of the Lord's Prayer that you'll find printed on the pew card. You should find a card in your pew has the prayer on it. It's on the back cover. And it'll be on the screen share too. So let us pray together the new version. Creator,
Redeemer, Sustainer, Way, Truth, and Life, Force of Love and Light, flowing within and all around us, may your realm of compassion, justice, and peace rule our world. Thank you for nurturing and guiding us, for giving us and helping us forgive, and leading us away from harmful desires. Please save us from all forms of evil, for you are our source, our home, our power, all goodness and beauty forever.
Two scriptures. The first is from Genesis and the second is from John. Now God said to Abram, go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you. I will make of you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great, so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and the one who curses you, I will curse. And in you, all the families of the earth shall be blessed. So Abram went, as God had told him. And the second reading is from the New Testament, John chapter 3, verses 1 to 12 and 19 to 21. Now there was a Pharisee named Nicodemus, a leader of the Jews. He came to Jesus by night and said to him, Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do apart from the presence of God. Jesus answered him, very truly, I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God without being born from above. Nicodemus said to him, how can anyone be born after having grown old? Can one enter a second time into the mother's womb and be born? Jesus answered, very truly, I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and spirit. What is born of the flesh is flesh, and what is born of the spirit is spirit. Do not be astonished that I said to you, you must be born from above. The wind blows where it chooses, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit. And Nicodemus said to him, how can these things be? Jesus answered him, "Are you a teacher of Israel, and yet you do not understand these things? Very truly, I tell you, we speak of what we know and testify to what we have seen, yet you do not receive our testimony. If I have told you about earthly things and you do not believe, how can you believe if I tell you about heavenly things? This is the judgment, that the light has come into the world and people loved darkness rather than light because their deeds were evil. For all who do evil hate the light and do not come to the light, so that their deeds may not be exposed. But those who do what is true come to the light, so that it may be clearly seen that their deeds have been done in God."
Thank you, Joey. Thank you for reading that beautifully. I'm reading it as if it almost made sense. How are we ever going to find our way out of the mess that we have made of this world? We have allowed forces of greed to rule and ruin the planet for their own profit, even though, like cancer cells, they are killing the host that they need for survival. Our culture has cultivated selfishness and violence as virtues, while marginalizing or corrupting the spiritual communities whose scriptures stand unequivocally in favor of nonviolence and love of neighbor as ourself. We are a long way from the promised land of the realm of God on earth, and a long way from our ideal selves. So how are we going to change? Well, we are not the first to struggle with that question. Our time may be different, our situation may be different, but this is an old question. Religion is the collected wisdom of people who have gone through similar wildernesses to what we're going through, seeking a way to a promised land. God called Abraham to go from your country and your kindred to the land that I will show you. God asked Abraham to make a courageous journey for the sake of future generations. Abraham had to leave his secure, known way of life and go on nothing but faith into a new land, into a whole new way of being. Surely, God is calling us to make a similar journey of faith now. Go from your country to the land that I will show you. God's land, God's realm. We know from Jesus, we know from the scriptures of all traditions, what that promised land is like. It is a land that follows the laws of compassion and love, justice and peace for all, where the earth is a garden that we hand on in better shape than we found it, so that life may be sustained and enjoyed for generations to come. This has been humanity's wisest, highest vision for thousands of years. And many, many over the centuries have been as brave and faithful as Abraham to try to get us there. We can think of people from this congregation. Think of Bill Coffin, William Sloan Coffin. Think of Martha Mannheim. Think of so many who have been brave and faithful trying to get us there. So now we are the ones. Now we need to make our journey to the land God is showing us. And we know full well the inner and outer obstacles. We know how hard it is. We know how impossible it seems. And yet we also know that the survival of life on earth depends on us making this journey. How do we get there? Martin Smith wrote in his classic Lenten book, A Season for the Spirit, "The scriptures speak of a breaking down of the old way of being a person and the discovery of a completely new one. They speak of our need to be born again. They speak of crucifying the old self with Christ. Nothing milder than these expressions will do justice to the radical change in our living meant by the word metanoia, the repentance that Jesus proclaimed after he emerged from the wilderness. Metanoia, meaning literally in the Greek, to go beyond where our spirit is now, to evolve our consciousness. Go to the land that I will show you, the scriptures say, the land you will find by completely changing your life and your mind. Albert Einstein said, "The release of the power of the atom has changed everything except our way of thinking. Thus, we drift toward a catastrophe of unparalleled magnitude." The American general Omar Bradley said, "If we continue to develop our technology without wisdom or prudence, our servant may prove to be our executioner." He said, "We have grasped the mystery of the atom and rejected the Sermon on the Mount." Now, it's understandable why our society has made gods out of technology and militarism and turned away from the God of the Sermon on the Mount. Technology and weapons change things quickly and with some degree of certainty in the short run, anyway. Faith, on the other hand, has uncertain results by definition, and often it leads us more deeply into the wilderness rather than straight to the promised land, 40 years or 40 days and 40 nights. Nicodemus was a Pharisee and a leader of the Jewish establishment who came to Jesus by night. That's an important detail. Night represents confusion in the Gospel of John, or being lost without vision. But there is hope in the night. There's always hope in the night for those who long for the light and keep seeking until they find it. Now, Nicodemus clearly has the longing, and Jesus understands this and says, "Very truly, I tell you, no one can see the realm of God without being..." Now this is what Nicodemus came for, okay? To see the realm of God. What is the way? And we can picture Nicodemus leaning forward. Yes. Being what? You know, make it clear. Tell me the steps. And then Jesus finishes the sentence, "Without being born anew, born from above." And Nicodemus is dismayed. You know, this is absurd. He responds, "How can anyone do that? It's impossible." And Jesus answers even more absurdly, eventually saying, "The wind blows where it chooses, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit." You know, it seems as if Jesus is intentionally confounding Nicodemus, or the Gospel of John is trying to intentionally confound us, like a Zen koan. Just like a Zen koan. He's leading Nicodemus not by a clear path of light, but into a wilderness or a dark night of soul. The 20th century mystic and monk Thomas Merton wrote about it this way, that the spirit enters a wilderness and travels blindly in directions that seem to lead away from vision, away from God. And Merton says that the way through a wilderness like that is to just maintain a blind, groping desire for the destination, for God, for the promised land. So we need to allow silence and emptiness and longing to work on us, the way a chrysalis works on a caterpillar, breaking it down and reshaping it into a butterfly. In Zen Buddhist tradition, the way to solve a koan, an impossible teaching, like the sound of one hand clapping, you know, what is the sound of one hand clapping? The way to solve it is to wait in stillness for it to work a change in our consciousness. In Christianity, we would say to wait for the Spirit to work a change in our consciousness. My brother is a Buddhist teacher, and he and I both actually say that. We both use the word Spirit to change our consciousness. So nothing is going to change in this world. Nothing is going to change in ourselves, in our lives, unless we change our thinking, unless we abandon our old way of seeing reality and let the Spirit lead us in new and unexpected ways. And this is what Jesus wanted for Nicodemus and wants for us. And the good news is that it seems to be happening today. Social scientists are documenting a rising evolution of consciousness toward oneness. Its greater wisdom and capacity for love may change the world in ways that seem impossible now. Michael Nagler wrote the book, The Search for a Nonviolent Future. And in it, he talks about the people who formed that amazing community in Colombia called Gaviotas as a model of self-sufficiency and sustainability, living nonviolently in a war zone and healing a damaged and barren landscape. Miracles have happened there because they are following the spirit, their inspiration through that wilderness. For instance, they found a certain pine tree that can survive in acidic, dry, shallow soil. And they planted millions of them. The pines changed the microclimate, increasing annual rainfall. And then in their shade, in the shade of those pines as they grew, a richly diverse primordial rainforest sprang up, evidently from seeds that were hiding in the shallow soil, waiting who knows how many eons for the right conditions to bloom again. The seeds of the Garden of Eden are waiting everywhere, dormant in Earth's sacred ground. And we cannot know for certain what pines the Spirit will have us plant, but we can have faith that God's realm of revolutionary love is within and among us, waiting for people who believe in its possibility, who seek it with all their heart, who open to the Spirit's guidance and power, and who give their lives to that journey. This is the role that we were evolved to play, to serve the Spirit of life so that the earth may flourish for generations to come. Go from your country and your kindred to the land that I will show you, and I will bless you so that you will be a blessing. Let us pray together in silence, making clear the intention of our heart to seek that land and that new day, giving our life to the journey. Let us pray. Amen. Let's put our hearts and minds together in a spirit of prayer. Holy God, higher power, however we think of you, spirit of this earth, of the universe, we confess that we are confounded by our lives, by this world. Thank you for the reminder to breathe. Thank you for the assurance that you flow through the wind and our breath, our lungs, our bodies, the bodies of all beings. Thank you for our brothers and sisters, the plants and the creatures of the woods and the air and the waters. Thank you for all that we can learn by being still and listening and watching both the world around us and our own inner spirit. Thank you for all that you have done to prove that you are the greatest force in the universe, bringing out of the universe into being out of nothing, gathering dust and gas and debris and forming stars and galaxies, taking lifeless earth and sparking life in single cells and bringing those cells together to form communities, bodies, and those bodies into communities. And here we are. How can we doubt that you have a purpose for us in this beautiful, beautiful dance? We have our place. Please help us when we are lost, and help our culture, which is lost, to listen and feel and find the way. And we thank you so much for those who have come before, who have found it by listening deeply themselves. Johann Sebastian Bach, oh my. These wonderful instrumentalists and singers, oh my. Those who wrote the poetry of the King James Version, and those like Maggie who are rewriting it today. My, my, my. So much beauty and so much wisdom and so many hearts finding the way. How can we doubt? So here we are in this wilderness, doubting, being tried, thinking it's impossible. Please help us to keep our groping desire, our longing, keep following toward the light. Thank you for all those who are with us on this journey today, and help us to each go out into this world and help as we can. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Please remember that we're taking our offering online on the welcome page of our website, or you can send donations into the church by mail. In the sanctuary, you can place your offering in the basket on the table in the back. Many people need the comfort and support that this church provides, so let us respond to that need by making our offering in the spirit of prayer, acting from our heart by spiritual intuition, letting the Spirit guide our heart and our hand. however and whenever and whatever we give. Please stand if you are able for the benediction. The benediction is adapted from the first letter of Peter, who was that voice in the prelude. We are living in a time of great transition. Therefore, be mindful, centered, and disciplined in your spiritual practice. Above all, maintain constant, generous-hearted love. For that love will keep you on the sacred way through this time toward a new world. Extend extravagant hospitality to all. Serve with whatever gifts you have been given, and be good stewards of the manifold grace of God. Let the Holy Spirit be your power and guide, and God's love and life and light will shine through you, blessing you and creating the realm of God on earth around you. Go in that faith and that peace. Amen. Amen.